The Stern-Gerlach device can be seen as a kind of a filter. Initially, spin is randomly oriented, but after passing the device, the electrons deflecting upward will have spin up relative to the device axis, and those deflecting downward will have spin down. If we block electrons deviating downwards, it will become some kind of a filter that transmits spin up electrons and blocks spin down ones. In a sequence of two devices, the second one will transmit all incoming electrons because they already have their spins up along the z-axis, and the filter transmits spin-up electrons. Let's make another sequence consisting of a z-axis filter which blocks spin-down electrons, followed by a Stern-Gerlach device which blocks spin-up electrons. If we send electrons to such a chain of filters, there will be no electrons at the output. The first filter transmits spin-up electrons and the second one blocks spin-up electrons relative to the z-axis. So if the spin is up along the z-axis, then it is definitely not down along the same axis. Everything is quite logical so far. It's interesting to see what happens if we place one device oriented along the z-axis and the second one oriented along the perpendicular x-axis. If an electron were a classical magnet and deflected upward in the first device, then it would not deviate anywhere at all in the second device. Its poles would be in the same conditions. Inhomogeneity of the external magnetic field would not affect the magnet, and it would hit the center of the screen. But an electron cannot hit the center of the screen. In relation to spin, an electron is a two-state system. It must deflect either up or down. It turns out that about 50% of the electrons that have passed the first filter will deviate upwards along the x-axis and 50% downward. That is in fact to the right and left. It seems strange, but an electron that has spin up along the z-axis also has a 50% chance to have its spin oriented up along the x-axis. In this situation, even quantum mechanics cannot predict which way a particular electron will deviate. Moreover, it says that this is fundamentally impossible to do. As we'll see later, the mathematical formulation of quantum mechanics allows us to calculate the probabilities of an event, but it does not allow us to predict the result of a single measurement. This fact is not a limitation of quantum mechanics itself. This is a fundamental aspect of nature. This example also shows that it's impossible to visualize spin as a classical vector. After all, it's not determined before the measurement. It only has probabilities of pointing in one direction or another. Spin is the simplest example of a more general fact that quantum mechanical objects and its characteristics cannot be visualized or imagined. Notice that a macroscopic magnet contains a lot of electrons and it is pulled to the right by the half of the electrons and pulled to the left by the other half. As a result, it does not deviate and hits the center of the screen, according to the predictions of classical physics. So classical physics comes from quantum mechanics by averaging over a large number of particles. Let's add a third filter that passes electrons with spin down relative to the z-axis. If there were no filter in the middle, the situation would be identical to the one we're already familiar with. There would be no electrons at the output. However, after passing the second filter, electrons will have their spin up along the x-axis. If these electrons pass through the third filter, then due to the symmetry considerations, 50% of them will have their spin down relative to the z-axis. In other words, if we take the number of electrons that have passed the first filter for 100%, then the output of the second filter will be 50% and the output of the third 25%. Adding a filter in the middle, oddly enough, leads to an increase in the number of electrons at the output from 0 to 25%. Actually, you can use photons instead of electrons and polarizers instead of Stern-Gerlach devices to see the strange quantum effect at home. That's because the polarization of a photon plays the same role as the spin of an electron. This behavior can only be explained by assuming that after passing through the second filter, an electron forgets that its spin has ever been directed up along the z-axis. The measurement of spin along the x-axis makes irrelevant previous information about its value relative to the z-axis. This situation occurs every time when two quantities cannot be measured simultaneously. In this case, the two quantities are the directions of spin relative to different axes. Notice that we cannot measure the spin relative to two axes at once. It is impossible to create a magnetic field pointing at two different directions at the same time. A more famous example of a similar situation is the Heisenberg uncertainty principle. It's impossible to simultaneously measure position and momentum of a particle with absolute accuracy. The measurement of one affects the other. Okay, let's summarize. Before the actual measurement, none of the classical characteristics objectively exists. We cannot assume that spin had a certain direction before we observed the deviation of the electron. This general statement applies to all observable quantities. In general, it's impossible to predict the result of a single measurement. Quantum mechanics allows to calculate only the probability of an event. There are physical quantities that cannot be known simultaneously. The measurement of one makes irrelevant previous information about the other. Deterministic classical laws come from probabilistic quantum mechanical ones by averaging over a large number of particles. In the next videos, we will take a closer look at the origins of this strange behavior of quantum systems.